the latecomers take their seats. Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, distinguished guests and lovely finalists, Commissioner Bulc and Director General Calleja, there you are on the front row, thank you very much. Good evening and a very, very warm welcome to you all to the European Mobility Week Award 2016 and the fifth SUMP Award on Urban Freight, hosted in this absolutely gorgeous venue by the European Commission, Directorates General for Mobility and Transport and for the Environment. Now, my name is Katrina, and I have the real privilege of being your mistress of ceremonies for the next hour. Now, I say the privilege because actually I've been hosting these awards for a few years now, and I think it's probably about time that I rolled my sleeves up and actually did something concrete, because I have learned so much sharing the stage with all these incredibly passionate and committed people over the years that I feel the time has come to get my hands dirty in the best possible way. These are really, really lovely awards, and the pride and the joy that the finalists and the winners demonstrate truly is infectious and really, really uplifting, and I hope that you will find the same. In fact, who knows me already? Hands up. Oh, not so bad, so a surprise for most of you, so good. Now, can I ask you please to keep your smartphone on silent and kind of aside, because it would be really brilliant if you could just put all your energies towards the stage to welcome all the fabulous people who are going to come on it tonight. The only thing I would ask is tweeting. That's the deal. So tweeting discreetly, please. That's when I would like you to multitask. The idea is to create a fantastic buzz around the finalists and the winners and this great initiative, okay? But announcing the winners is for a little bit later. First of all, I'm going to set the scene. And who better to help me do that than the lady on the front row? Can you please give a very, very warm welcome to the EU Commissioner for Transport, Violeta Bulc. Welcome to you. We shared a stage together, I think, about 2 years ago.
Yes.
So I'm going to put you in the spotlight and ask you a few questions, okay, if that's all right. A good one to start with is the theme this year. The theme this year is clean, shared, and intelligent mobility for 2017. What? They're big words, they're key words. What do they actually mean to you?
Well, first of all, if you allow me just to break a little bit your pattern and then just say thank you very much to all finalists. Your projects are really inspirational. And also thank you much to all national coordinators, because I know that you are behind the successful stories. But now let me try to answer really quickly your question. I think we are moving away from very technological orientation to a bit more people-focused orientation. Mm-hmm. And that's why I will try to answer, and I'm inviting you all to look at mobility from a very human perspective. The smart, intelligent, clean, whatever mobility you want to call it, is all about addressing humans' needs, our needs. It is about me, it's about you, it's about your neighbor, it's about your friend, your family. So when you put that into your perspective, mm-hmm. you start thinking through what do we really need, not what we want. Yeah, but what we really need in order to move forward, to move from point A to point B. That's why for me, this is about health. It's about how we really create environment where we can actually develop as individuals, human beings, in a healthy, effective way. It is about how to use public money. It's about efficiency. It's about how to the best plan the city and really put the mobility as the tool in a role of a tool to really address the primary needs of people.
And people's needs.
Exactly.
Yeah. Okay.
Yes.
So you talk a lot about humans there.
Yes.
And we've got words like shared, which is very human and cozy. But with that comes a lot of technological changes. So how does the transport sector embrace all of those changes?
Well, first of all, we ride on the wave of technological changes. We are users. And that's why we see now emergence of new business models and emergence of new solutions also in the city levels. This is, for example, I'm talking about sharing economy, I'm talking about collaborative economy, I'm talking about mobility as a service instead of transport and instead of buses and trains. We're talking about how to combine all these different modes and really come up with a solution that addresses the needs of mobility, that we are addressing the needs not in a prescriptive way, so only at 12 o'clock the car will or the bus will start from a particular bus station, but we say where are people that need the mobility as a service. So all that is really enabled by the technology. So we don't know exactly what's going to come out tomorrow, but if we are really listening carefully, if we really try to understand what technologies are bringing and then transform them into useful business models, we'll be maybe surprised. And we see what's happening with the automotive industry. I mean, 5 years ago, it was almost a dream to talk about autonomous driving. Today, everybody's talking about connected vehicles, autonomous driving, driverless vehicles. And all this is emerging, and you guys need to pay attention to that because the cities will look different in 10, 20 years because of this emergence of new technologies.
But the way you describe it, I mean, it's exciting for you because you're really in the thick of it.
Yes.
I mean, really in the thick of it. So I've got to ask the question, you're here on the stage, I have you captured, which I guess any of you would like to ask, which is really, what are your political priorities in this area? What's the big focus for you?
Political priorities are driven by, of course, by our stakeholders, and we just try to embrace them and create a chapeau story. So currently, I can share, we have 6 priorities because it seems that these are the priorities that are of most concerns to our stakeholders. One is, of course, digitalization, technology that we talked before. Mm-hmm. The other one is decarbonization, so to really ensure that we live, that we breathe healthy air and that we transport pays the share pursuing this kind of goals. The third one is, of course, very much impacting also mobility as a concept, is people-focused solutions.
Mm-hmm.
But we cannot do that with all this without really good investment and good innovation. So innovation and investments are driving decarbonization, digitalization, and people-focused solutions. So these are the priorities really on the top of everything. But I'm not sure if you're interested what is happening in this year, what new things, and this I will read because I don't want to miss some. But there are some really exciting things coming up. And it's good that you maybe pay attention. First is...
Pay attention. Good. No, I was just making sure. Pay attention.
First is knowledge and innovation community on urban mobility, which will be established in March 2017. It's a couple of days. Transport innovation challenge that we will launch in summer this year. Political declaration on deployment of clean buses to be signed before summer 2017. And by the way, in December 1st, we launch a new financial innovative tool to support all the shift from dirty to clean vehicles, special buses in the city. So I hope you're going to take an advantage of that, and you can apply directly as cities. You don't need to go to member states for that. And the last but not least, relaunch of the high-level group on the EU Innovation Partnership on Smart Cities in autumn 2017. You loved it so much that we had to support it again.
Okay. Thank you very much. And tell me, have you tried a driverless car?
Yes.
And?
I love it.
Okay.
I have to tell you the dream, because years ago, I was sharing with my some engineering colleagues in the engineering group. I said, guys, I cannot tell you how much I'm looking forward to the day when I will sit in a vehicle, whatever that's going to be, and I will say, not beam me, but drive me to a new destination, I will take a book and read.
Ah, you answered. I was about to ask you, when it's driverless, what are you going to do? Eat an ice cream or read a book?
Read a book.
Read a book. Okay, very good. All right. Thank you so very much. I'll grab that. Thank you. And a warm round of applause. In fact, I've only been given one of those, so I had to steal it from you. Thank you. So, please now put your hands together again. There's a lot of clapping. For those of you who've been here before, you know I make you clap a lot. So, could you please put your hands together again for the Director General of DG Environment, Daniel Calleja. Please, welcome. photographer, wherever you are. So, I start off with you with maybe something that doesn't sound too positive, and that's something on air quality. Mm-hmm. More than 130 cities in Europe are actually in breach of air quality standards. So what more should we be doing? What more actions must be taken in that area?
Well, before speaking about air pollution, I would like to thank you for your words of introduction and to say it is a pleasure to be here with Commissioner Bulc in this very exciting event. You were rightly saying that air pollution is the biggest problem we have now in Europe. 400,000 premature deaths every year because of the problems of air quality in the cities. And I think we have to address this problem. And it is not just an issue that we can solve at European level with regulations, with directives, although we are making a lot of progress. It is something which we can only solve with the cities. And the good news is that the cities are taking this very seriously. We have increasingly, in all the European capitals, new solutions, new measures, alternative fuels, clean transport, electric vehicles, more public transport, in some cases some restrictions to traffic, which play a role. So I think the good news and the message is, yes, there are environmental problems, but the cities are the best placed actors to deal with these issues. And Europe is very seriously tackling these matters. We are now engaging in the air quality forums. Mm-hmm. We are working with the cities. We are trying to develop solutions. We are trying to put in place new tools. We are trying also to say something which is very important, and which Mrs. Bulc was mentioning. Violeta Bulc was saying, at the end of the day, our work has no purpose if it's not for the service of the citizens. 80% of the citizens will be living in cities. So I think it is possible, working with the cities, exchanging best practices to find solutions to problems such as air pollution, which I think will be one of the biggest challenges that we have ahead of us.
I think you're right, and I think public perception, we see people in China on bikes with masks and think it's over there, and perhaps we're unaware quite how much it's on our doorstep. But you talked about the real cities being at the centre of it, so that leads me very nicely into my next question, which is, could you tell me a little bit more about the new urban agenda for the EU, and how exactly can it help the development of urban mobility specifically?
Well, we had a very important development, which was the Amsterdam Pact, an agreement to develop a strong EU agenda working with the cities, an agreement with the mayors to work in sustainable solutions, an agreement to work in the circular economy, to deal with issues like waste, to deal with issues like noise, to deal with air pollution, to put sustainability at the center of our lives, because sustainability is also at the basis of great opportunities, not only to increase the quality of life of citizens, but also of great economic opportunities for cities. Growth and jobs are more and more linked to the circular economy. There is no successful business model if it is not sustainable. Sustainability has to be mainstreamed across our policies. The European Union has an agenda, the urban agenda. We have even an international agreement in the UN, the Quito conference, with its conclusions. And I think our biggest challenge now is implementation. Europe does not need more legislation. What we need is smart measures, sustainability practices, working together with the cities and developing the solutions for the cities of the future.
But I think that's the crux, where you say it's the implement, it's passing to action. And in fact, that leads me on to my next question. Thank you very much, very nicely, which is, we've been hearing today lots of fantastic stories, and tonight, fantastic stories about really what's happening on the ground in different cities around Europe. And Europe is good at that, this sharing of best practice, but how do we get more of it out there to inspire more people to follow those cities' leads? I was very bossy earlier, talked about tweet, 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 creative buzz. What else can we do?
Well, I think you're right, Catherine, that we have to do a lot more in disseminating good practices, in creating awareness, in developing communication, in generating role models. And I think this is why this ceremony is so important, because we have great candidates, great experiences in sustainable mobility. Let me share with you some of the things we are doing in our DG. First of all, we also have the green capitals of Europe. This year is Essen, last year it was Ljubljana, before it was Bristol. There are cities which are putting in place very good solutions for sustainable mobility, for green growth, to have better quality of life. We also have for the small cities the Green Leaf Awards. We try to every year recognize good sustainable practices. But we need to bring the citizens more into the picture. 95% of all the EU citizens believe that one of the greatest added values of the European Union is environment, is sustainability. And 2 out of 3 say we should do more. Why don't we work more closely with the cities? Why don't we expand the good successful practices? Why don't we disseminate more? There is also important funding. We have more than 300 million euros in our budget with regional policy with a very strong urban dimension. So I think spreading awareness, disseminating good practices, sharing solutions which work. We have developed a toolbox which allows to decide and to check if the practices of a city are sustainable or not, and to rank the city. I think we need to do more, and we need to bring in the citizens in. And I think the governance will be a very important feature. Our citizens are asking us, they every day, to come with more sustainable solutions, to improve the quality of life. I think this is a great challenge, and I think we can deliver if we are able to work together.
Okay, but I think you've been very clear about, apart from the sharing, you know, there's funding, get your hands on it, there's a toolbox, get your hands on it. So, last, very rapid, driverless car, did you do it?
I have not driven, I have not had the chance. I don't work in transport, but I'm sure okay. Violeta Bulc is going to invite me to.
If you were to, would you eat an ice cream or read a book?
I think I would read an ice cream because I want to keep my eye on the, just in case the machine doesn't work.
Okay. Thank you. I will grab that. You may have a seat. Thank you. A warm round of applause, please, for the Director General. Right. All settled comfortably. Yes? Because we are about to launch straight into the 5th SUMP Award on Urban Freight, we're now just going to find out a little bit more about our 3 finalists. Thank you.
out. One day we are actually going to be moving as fast as those sped up videos. That's what I fear. So, ladies first, if you may come, and then gentlemen. So, you, Commissioner, are going to announce the winner of the 5th SUMP Award on Urban Freight, and you afterwards are going to take hold of something very heavy. So, first of all, Commissioner, it is for you to announce the winner.
I really don't know who the winner is, but I'd like to really congratulate all, because all solutions seem to be multimodal solutions, promoting new ways of moving forward and keeping the city clean, efficient, and sustainable. And of course, using intelligence as we go. So, you are happy with everything?
Just to give them a little teaser, okay. So they know why the city...
For its well-thought-out comprehensive freight strategy, for its planning approach, starting with identification of problems and finishing with the evaluation of measures for the promotion of innovative logistics schemes, the winner of the 5th Award for Sustainable Urban Mobility Planning is Brussels.
Brussels!
Of course, I'm very happy because, you know, Brussels for a long time has been the bad kid in town, or the bad kid in Europe, or the bad kid in class on mobility. Some of you will live here, some of you will experience the city. We are really a city for cars, and we want to become a city for people, and I think we are doing it right now. And it's a lot of things, and we are no longer, because we got a prize, and we have a good plan, and I would like to thank all the people of the administration, Marientes and our team, and everybody, because they've worked on it, and I'm pretty aware we still have a long way to go, many things to do, but we are on our way now, we are changing, and you know, I'm so proud that the capital of Europe, because we should say it, Brussels is the capital of Europe, and we will remain the capital of Europe, that Brussels is finally getting, you know, what many other cities are doing already, on mobility in general, on freight mobility. And so I'm very proud that you have chosen it, because Brussels is often a candidate, often we just fell away, but now we won, so we are so happy. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I'm very proud of you, because you're not an English native and you speak way faster than me, so that is an achievement. Your excitement is infectious. Thank you so very
much.
Thank
you very much.
And I do also. I'm a Brussels resident. I applaud you. Thank you so very
much.
A warm round of applause. You may take your seat. Okay, so, and keep hold of it, because somebody will pinch it off the bar if you don't, I'm just telling you. So, we're pretty much halfway through the awards. Are you feeling good?
Yeah.
Are you feeling good?
Yeah.
Yeah. Hands in the air, who has tweeted? Pathetic. Really? Yeah, pathetic. Okay, hands in the air, who could actually tweet still? Oh. Okay, well, make sure you 5 extra do tweet, and the rest of you tweet again, and then teach the people who don't know how to tweet how to tweet. Very good. Right, you need a tweeting masterclass. Now, before I take us into European Mobility Week Award 2016, we have a little interlude. Now, this evening is a very important landmark in the history of European Mobility Week, and we are actually shortly going to announce the winner of the 15th edition of the award. That's a lot of years. And in all that time, and even now, cities are still as excited and passionate and committed about what they do. In fact, in 2016, there was a record participation in European Mobility Week. 2,427 cities, a fantastic response. And proof that the week has been growing like a lovely child over the years, over the last 15 years. So let us all just sit back and relax, as these two here are. And we're going to go back in time now, and we're going to revisit some of the highlights of the past. And I've actually got a few very important people to help me with that. Please welcome to the stage. A round of applause, please. They are all very efficiently in size order. So, given very your warmest vibes, I think we're starting with this little lady here, is that correct? Can I start with you? Okay, my dear, let's go.
But Carl won the award 50 years ago. Now they are spending more money on electric buses.
So congratulations to Krakow and to you for starting us off, because that's scary. Monsieur.
Geneva is 42% better at Easy Clean Transport since they won the award.
42% better, thank you very much. And you did brilliantly. So just move forward a little bit, my lovelies. Okay, so.
Ferrara also won in 2002 for having the best action plan. Lent had the best communication strategy in the first year of the award.
As I said to this lady in rehearsal, communication strategy coming very nicely out of her mouth there, I thought. Well done you. Very good. So.
Since 2003, people in Ljubljana have changed the way they travel, and the streets have changed too. Lent won the award in 2004. Which focused on safe streets for children.
So Ljubljana and Nantes, very well done. Well done to you. Sir, you are next.
In Copenhagen, the award led to better awareness of car-free city centres. Since Lyon won the award, sustainable mobility is now really popular. 3,000 people joined the last year's campaign.
That's impressive. Thank you very much. Sir.
Since 2007, it's much easier to walk and cycle in Koprivnica. Budapest won in 2008. Now it has a sustainable urban mobility plan and even better public transport. Gävle won in 2009. It's a real public city. It even has special intersections for cycling.
Are you done? You had a lot, didn't you? You had a lot. Well done, and to you.
Since Almada won in 2010, it's become even nicer for walking and cycling. It's also got new electric buses and a tram. The city of Bologna paid 80 people to build a pedestrian area in the city centre in less than 10 months. Zagreb won in 2012, and it announced this year that it's building a new cycling highway.
Good, and she has a big smiley face on the back of that as well, so you should all have big smiley faces. Thank you very much. And last but not least, I come to you.
Ljubljana is the only city that won the award twice. But they won't stop here. They're going to keep joining in European Mobility Week every year.
Go Ljubljana!
Östersund won the award in 2014, and this is one step more to help it become a fossil fuel-free city by 2030. Thanks to European Mobility Week, more and more people are walking and cycling in Moravia. So next step is to encourage car drivers to use clean vehicles.
Thank you very much, and well done also for fossil fuel free city. That's a mouthful. So, before I let these lovely people go, if you'd like to take a photograph, can I ask you both to come behind? I'm going to stay out of the way. Can you all shovel up, come in this end, please? Voila. All straight so we can see you all. Don't get squeezed out by the boys, lovely lady there. Yes. Can you go about three or four steps back in a straight line? Voila. Okay, big cheesy smiles, like Christmas is here, again and again and again. And some nice clapping, thank you so very much. Okay, you may take a seat, and our gentleman here may lead us out this way if you follow. We have a bit of traffic congestion. It's congestion. It's transport, exactly. Where is the sustainable urban mobility? We're congested. Another round of applause for these lovely people. Thank you. That's an absolute pleasure, and they did a great job. Yay! Didn't hear you two go, yay, when you've done your questions. So, we must be on tenterhooks to find out the winner of the European Mobility Week Award 2016, but hold on just a little bit longer, because we're going to find out a bit more about our three finalists. Thank you.
So, for its vision of sustainable mobility for the future and for the present. For honoring active travelers like cyclists and pedestrians. For its excellent promotional outreach and involvement of partners. The winner of the 2016 European Mobility Award is Malmö.
People, isn't it? First of all, thank you so much to the Commission for this fantastic award. We are so thrilled and so honoured to receive this. And we also want to thank you for putting the focus on mobility like this. This is really, really important, and for doing it for such a long time. We also want to take the opportunity briefly to just say thank you to Eurocities for allowing us a strong voice towards the Commission, towards the European Union, and also for the platform to be able to share knowledge and to share experiences with each other. We want to mention Milan Obradovic, who was the deputy mayor who initiated our application for the Mobility Week, and with his strong commitment and engagement made this possible. But also the officials in our administration in Malmö. Olaf was one of them. We have another group in the audience. Who made that political vision come true. I think that is so important to mention, all the people who made this happen by their hard work. But last, and definitely not least, maybe most importantly, I want to thank the citizens of Malmö and the local businesses in Malmö who co-created the Malmö Mobility Week, and who, by doing that, helped us establish this view of what our city could be in the future. And this is, I think, is so important. As Mr. Kerr was saying earlier, we don't need more legislation, we need implementation. And this is what we do together with our citizens and together between our cities. So thank you so much. We're so honored and so thrilled. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Be careful. Do not trip down the stairs with that thing in your hand. No. Okay, so you think it's all over? Not quite yet. Before you get your hands on food and drink and pat yourselves and all of your peers on the back for your general fabulousness, let's just take a look at the 2017 campaign video that reflects the theme that I chatted about with the Commissioner: clean, shared and intelligent mobility. Thank you.
Humankind has always evolved through sharing. Why would it be different today? In our constantly congested cities, where parking spaces are scarce and pollution is increasing, owning a car doesn't make much sense anymore. Sharing is the way to go, and innovative apps make it easy. Public transport, shared cars and bikes. Be part of this new wave.
So, I would personally like my own spaceship to avoid traffic jams. That would just be the most delightful thing. And I find him very cute, that little character. I would share a car with him. I think he's quite a sweet little animation. So I hope that gets you feeling excited about September. It is surely going to creep up way faster than you think. But for now, our ceremony is drawing to a close. Can I just do the polite British thing that I always do, which is to dispense a few thank yous. That's very important, and they're very heartfelt, to the European Commission for organising these awards, particularly to have tonight with us Commissioner Bulc and Director General Calleja. Thank you so very much for your time. Thank you also to our fantastic finalists, our two very worthy winners, and of course those gorgeous children who took us back in time. That was really delightful, to put sort of urban mobility with kids. That was nice, I like that. Thank you of course to the organisers, EuroCities, who have just been mentioned, and to ICF Mostra. And last but by no means least, thank you so much to all of you, who I really did feel their support. I asked them at the beginning, stay focused on stage, and I don't think too many of you were looking at your phones. Now is the time for tweeting, but thank you for applauding so enthusiastically throughout. Before I call some of you forward to say a final cheese for our photographer, please don't forget to tweet the winners, or get your kids to tweet the winners. I don't care who, to your friends, to your neighbours, to your cats, to your grannies. I even added President Trump, only because I thought it might be quite funny to find out how he might reply. But there we go, I leave that to you. I will definitely be tweeting because, as I said to you at the outset, and it isn't just a presenter thing to say, these awards really, really, really are quite close to my heart, and I always leave on a very high note, inspired by how excited and joyful people are at their wins and all of their efforts. So I really do feel privileged to be part of this growing community. And on that positive note, I'd like to ask eventually if you two would please stay on the stage. Can the winners of the European Mobility Week Award and Fifth SUMP Award please come to the stage, and can the finalists remain on standby for their turn in the spotlight and to appear in front of Mr. Paparazzi there. The rest of you, go eat, drink and be merry. Have a very, very good evening, and eventually, after tomorrow's proceedings, a very safe and sustainable journey home. I wish you well. Thank you so very, very much. Good evening.
Thank you.